This video is brought to you by my supporters on Patreon, Buy Me Coffee and YouTube. If you'd like to support me, you can find the links below. Right after my last upload, as any YouTuber would, I was reading my comments when I saw this. I think this comment neatly, in an organized manner, lists out all the common narratives that go around regarding claims of science that originated in India but didn't get credit, but later became accepted as Western science found proof for it. Normally, I wouldn't make an entire video on a single comment, but this one is such a good opportunity for us to exercise some critical thinking skills that I couldn't pass this up. Hi, my name's Pranav. You're watching Science with Dope. Let's begin. Let's read this comment line by line and respond to each part. Critical thinking is necessary but must have some groundwork. Okay, what's that groundwork? The concept of science is dope is not new in the world. According to Western scientists, anything that doesn't fit into the area of research and results or theory is dope. Hopefully, they change their mindset little by little. I don't know if he's using the word dope to mean invalid, but this notion of Western scientists is a pretty common one. I'll address that soon. The rest of this is what I want to address now. Let's say I'm a researcher who researches ghosts, but the mainstream scientists don't accept my research saying ghosts don't exist. I get really mad and say, these Western scientists and their rules, they don't accept anything that doesn't fit into their science. See the problem here? If you're gonna claim that something exists but provide no evidence for it, I don't have to accept what you say, no matter what it is. When you say that something exists or something is real, that is an empirical claim. Without evidence, it's as good as claiming that you have invisible wings and can fly when nobody's looking. You can say anything similar that can't be tested, like your area of research deals with another dimension of creatures or energies or whatever.
It could burn up the person.
Did you film this?
Huh? From a distance, they filmed it, bad filming, you know, they were not really looking for it.
This is simply the notion of unfalsifiability. I've gone into detail in this video. I'll leave the link in the description. The blame here does not fall on science, but on the researcher who can't provide evidence for his claim. Initially, they didn't believe there are positive effects of meditation yoga practices which originated from our culture. Now they have multi-billion dollar industries because some world-leading top universities have given proof that they are beneficial. Okay, let's clear something up about the word proof. Science does not and cannot prove anything. Proof is something that's only possible in the domain of something like mathematics. Science deals with the real world, with reality. In other words, it's empirical. And anything empirical does not work with proofs. It works with evidence. I discuss in detail in this video, link in the description. In the place of proof, you should have used the word evidence. Also, you say they didn't believe. This they refers to Western scientists, I suppose. I see this notion going around of Western science often.
Unless there's a Western scientific proof about something, people just don't buy it anymore.
Western sciences is going to discover 20 million things in the next 20 years.
Absolutely.
About Ayurveda.
Absolutely, they are going ahead with this.
Stop it, get some help.
This Eastern-Western dichotomy does not exist in science. There is only one science. If this research that found convincing evidence in favor of meditation or yoga or Ayurveda came from India, the scientific community would still accept it. It doesn't matter if it came from the West. Now, I think this commenter's problem is that we don't accept things from our culture until science finds evidence for it. Let me ask you this. There are some genuinely good ideas that came from India, like Indian numerals or some ideas from yoga and meditation, as you say. There are also bad ideas like Vastu Shastra, Panchabuddhas, or kinds of alternative medicine that are extremely harmful. All of those ideas came from India too. So you have good ideas and bad ideas, right? Just because some ideas are good doesn't mean we have to accept every single idea, does it? So my question is, how do you decide which ideas are good and which ones are bad? If only there was a way. Oh wait, evidence. You see which ideas have convincing evidence for them and you accept them. If there are ideas that go against evidence, you discard them. If we don't have enough evidence to conclude one way or the other, then you don't accept or discard them. This is important for an empirical claim. blame anyone who's disregarding evidence might as well be shooting themselves in the foot. Now back to your comment. I hope you understand why we can't accept every single idea. In our scriptures, the concept of atom and structure are already present, which are dated to thousands of years, but we blindly believe its origin is in Western science, which provided the proof to it. The structure of the atom is not there in our scriptures. What is present is someone metaphorically describing something very small, this very small entity that everything is made of. Now that's too vague and cannot be used to derive any further knowledge, and it's not based on evidence. It cannot be equated to the concept of atom in science, which is based on evidence. Also, again, there is no such thing as Western science. The distance between Earth and Sun is written in our Hanuman Chalisa, which these people don't know how to read. That is also present for thousands of years. But it's the Western science that provided the proof, and that's why you believe it. Okay, the Hanuman Chalisa is now thousands of years old. It was written in the 17th century, and I've made an entire video on this whole thing. You can find the link to it in the description. Check that out for a more elaborate explanation. But briefly here, the claim is from this verse that says, Yuga Sahasra Yojana, to be the distance to the sun. One yuga is 12,000 divine years. Not year, but divine year. Sahasra is the Sanskrit word for a thousand, and Yojana is approximated as 8 miles. Now let's ignore the fact that you're multiplying time and distance to get a distance value. We still have problems. Yuga is 12,000 divine years, and one divine year is 360 years, which means one yuga is 4.32 million years. So you have these two values. On what basis is 12,000 chosen and not 4.32 million? Is that just arbitrary? Let's come to Yojana now. It's approximated as 8 miles. I've seen other approximations of 9 miles, and I've seen all kinds of values between 5 and 9 miles. I've gone into more detail in that video, but basically when you have so many choices, how do you choose, or where the values chosen after the final answer was known? Where those values picked so that you get to that final answer? I can only speculate because I don't know, but neither do you or anyone else for that matter. But one thing's for sure, you can't calculate using an approximate value to get an accurate value. If the value for Yojana is an approximation, then this final value cannot be accurate, as many people claim. Ramanujan sir provided equations of many mathematical concepts, and according to him, that was the grace of a Devi, as he didn't receive any Western education. Again, I've made an entire video on Ramanujan giving credit to his one-of-a-kind mathematical genius while addressing the claims that his mathematical ability was the grace of God. But briefly here, Ramanujan was an amazing mathematician, but it's a fallacy of appealing to his authority to think that everything else he said was also right. Here's a similar example. If I was an Olympic athlete from 100 years ago and I can't explain how I'm jumping that high, I might feel that it's God giving me the ability to jump so high because I've been brought up in that religious environment. Does that mean I'm right though? I'll leave that open for you to think about and comment below. There's more. The latest example of battery found in the ruins of Egypt dated 3000 years back. Okay, I know where this is going. I don't want to read the rest because I don't know what to say at this point. If he's just gonna bring all these conspiracy theories. Again, I've made a shot on this battery claim. But even without that, just think about it. What would such a battery have been used for? Were there electrical implements that ran on battery power? Did people even know that electricity can be used to power things? Now, I'm not rejecting or discarding this idea. I'm only saying that it's extremely unlikely. But my mind is open to the evidence. Does that mean I'm open to the possibility? I mean, anything is possible. Flying pigs are possible. Completely logical and unlikely, but possible. Does that mean I believe it? Hell no. But if someone shows me a pig with wings that can fly, I'm gonna believe what's right in front of my eyes. You've shown me the evidence. I'm not open to the possibility. I'm open to the evidence. Please try to just go through the introduction of these two people and their work, because these were all dope until people give proof for them. Pingala and Shoshita. Many people of our nation didn't get the credit for their work in their field of science because they weren't able to provide proof to these Western scientists and their spoiled children. This is the last part of his comment. Sure, I will research more on them and give them ample credit if their works are genuine. But if their works are blown out of proportion, I'll say that too. Also, nobody deserves credit for saying a bunch of stuff. You only deserve credit if you're able to show evidence for what you're claiming. I hope I've made that clear. The theme of videos on this channel can often be unfriendly towards sponsors. As a result, I have to support myself and this content on generous support from all of you. The platforms Patreon and Buy Me Coffee are the ones I recommend for support because they take a smaller share of that revenue. Alternately, you can also support me on YouTube through memberships or that thanks button. You can also check out my website and my merch. Links are down below. If you like this video, you might also like the one I did on Ramanujan. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.